Hi there, ladies and gents. So, intervertebral discs. Discs between the vertebrae, inter meaning between, vertebrae, vertebral, discs. Brief overview of the anatomy. So, the discs, there are two components to. You have the outer layers, which is the annulus fibrosus, and then you have the inner centre, which is what we call the nucleus pulposus. So, demonstrated in red over here is the nucleus pulposus. Ignore the that's only an attachment to hold it in here, of course. And ignore this bit over here. I'll explain what that is in a few moments. But if you look at the model here, you can see. So you've got the discs. Now, there are 25 layers crisscrossed, eccentric. This is actually fibrocartilaginous material, essentially meaning it is cartilage. A little bit right, like the pin of your ear, also known as the auricle. And then there's also a fibrous component to it. And because there are these components to it, it makes it very, very tough. The other thing is that the layers, the 25 layers that are, they are crisscrossed. So they crisscrossed, and in doing so, it allows for the excessive torsion. Now, discs usually, what happens, so this is again, if you look at it from the lateral view, there's our anterior, there's the posterior. Discs usually, go, if I may use the term go, they slip, so commonly known as a slip disc, when we bend forwards, i.e. flex. So when we bend forward, what happens is the frontal aspect, what happens is excessive force is applied here, and the disc bulges backwards, so to speak. Now, if there is enough pressure and the torsion and the vectors are just exactly as they need to be, then that disc will slip. So what is a slip disc? A slip disc, as demonstrated here, is essentially the bulging of a disc. So we'll remove the vertebra, and you can see from the top now. So here's the front again, and there's the back. And as you can see over here, what's happened is the disc bulges backwards. Now, this is spinal cord again, just to remind ourselves. So discs don't go directly backwards except on the fewer occasion. More so, they go in that direction or that direction. So this is what I call posterolateral, because this is lateral. There's posterior. So they go posterolateral. So this is the most common direction of a disc going. Now, once a disc bulges, so a disc bulge technically is known as disc herniation. Now, a herniation, essentially what that does is if it's large enough, it'll compress the nerve that is passing by, as demonstrated in this model here. If you look on the correct side, the non-pathological side, or the side which has not got any ailments, you can see the disc is free to move, whereas here, it's trapped. And that nerve being trapped is what will give you a pain down, be it your leg if it's in the lumbar spine, or otherwise the arm if it's in your neck, because the nerves going down the arm come out from the neck, and going down the leg come out from the lumbar spine, respectively. So the disc bulge can become a prolapse, which essentially means it can crack all of this, and it can collapse, so to speak. So this thing can actually collapse. And if it goes one step further, then let's put this fella back on the middle. What can happen is the nucleus pulposus, the jelly-like substance inside the nucleus, can actually come outwards. It can actually break through the annulus fibrosus and seep outwards. This is what we call a disc, an IVD sequestration. So the disc herniation, you have a disc prolapse, and the worst one is a disc sequestration. If you get a sequestration, usually it'll occupy this space over here, thus possibly hitting the spinal cord in the spinal, in the C-spine, or even the T-spine, which is very rare, or otherwise in the spinal cord, in the lumbar spine, it'll hit the cauda equina. Remember, the spinal cord terminates at the L1 region, after which it becomes the cauda equina. And that can be lead to cauda equina syndrome, which is essentially a medical emergency. So, overview, discs, two components. Remind yourself that it's like a jam donut, whereby the jam inside is the nucleus pulposus, and the donut outside is the annulus fibrosus. You can get tears on this, and that's called an annular tear. And it takes about 3 to 4 years for a disc to essentially heal itself. There is a suggestion that you can repair a disc through manual therapy. I personally think that is not true. I have not yet in my experience been able to heal a disc, and that's seen patients, including my supervised training of 13 years, and I've still not seen that, so I find it hard to believe you can do. I hope that helps. Any questions, don't hesitate. Thank you for your time.